On this episode of Drinking Made Easy, we visit the city of a thousand steeples. We pop some bottles. Steve drops some knowledge.
I think that's how cold it is on the moon.
And someone busts out the straws.
Did he just say straws?
It's Drinking Made Easy, Montreal. I'm Zane Lamprey, and my job is to drink. I'm traveling around with my mascot, Steve McKenna, and my buddy, Bleepleus, as we explore the local drinking cultures, customs, and cocktails. Along the way, we'll soak in the local flavor in an effort to make drinking easy. Montreal is known for their old city, the new city, and hockey. We'll get to those in a bit, but first, the drinks. Our first stop serves up some of the biggest cocktails in Montreal. With three locations, La Distillery has been broadening the cocktail culture within Montreal for over 5 years. We make our way to their second location, where we meet up with mixologist Charles Landry and talk cocktails in the MTL.
We opened the first one in 2005, but Montreal at that time was not into cocktail that much.
Okay.
And the idea was, let's bring something that people can afford, like, and go and have a cocktail without the, did you say, like, pretentious? Like,
yeah, crafted cocktails.
Yeah.
We have mixology over here.
Yeah.
We have bartending over here.
Yeah.
And then somewhere in the middle is craft cocktails.
Yeah, right on.
There is a little bit of theatrics with the muddling, but it doesn't take 15 minutes to make the drink. It's, you can make it quickly, but it's still a crafted cocktail.
It is, yeah.
It's not coming off of a gun. It's not juice in a can. You're making all the ingredients fresh, but yet in front of the customer.
Exactly. Trying and developing some homemade syrup. So
okay.
Now we got like homemade tonic, hibiscus syrup, homemade grenadine.
We'll be using their house-made hibiscus syrup in a drink called the garter belt, or in French,
la jartelle.
Exactly, which is made with celery, hibiscus syrup, tonic, and gin. They offer up two sizes of mason jars. We are going for the hero size.
This is a liter. It basically gets you two drinks in one.
In one, yeah.
Start with freshly muddled celery. Fill the jar with ice. Then a squirt of the house-made hibiscus syrup. Then house-made tonic, which is made with
lemon, orange peel, citric acid. Boil for a long time.
Okay.
Then sit, strain, and there you go.
That's how you make tonic?
It is, yeah. And quinine, it's like the outside of the tree. How'd you call that?
Bark.
Bark? Yeah.
It's so it's like cinnamon in a way.
It is, yeah.
Ground up.
Right on.
Very cool. So that would be why it has the same color as the cinnamon water. Okay.
Followed by a 4-ounce pour of gin.
Here's two, four.
You don't need a tin for these cocktails. Just screw on the top and shake with a crazy face.
Oh, got some straws.
Did he just say straws?
Charles adds some straws.
Something has to happen when we put a straw in.
Oh yeah?
We gotta pound him.
Nice.
Triggering a race.
Steve, this is yours.
Oh, fantastic.
That one's yours.
But before they start, the drink is garnished with celery leaves. The drinks are finished, so the race can begin.
First one to finish is the winner.
Well, kind of the loser and the winner.
1, 2, 3, go.
And they're off. This here is the largest cocktail these boys have ever raced on.
Are you joking?
The gloves are coming off for this one.
McKenna pulls off the glove, and all three are keeping it close. This race is coming down to pure will. As they near the bottom, Lamprey separates himself from the pack. No one is gonna catch him, and Lamprey takes the victory.
Coming up on Drinking Made Easy, Steve dusts off an old college trick.
Can you use nose grease?
No, no. Oh my God. Welcome back to Drinking Made Easy in Montreal. As you know, this is a drinking game.
And it's also a drinking show.
Right.
And for all the rules, go to drinkingmadeeasy.com. Don't spill.
Yeah.
We are drinking our way through Montreal, and our next stop is a beer bar known for their stellar service. For 15 years, Bier Et Compagnie has been a staple in the beer culture of Montreal. Specializing in unique glassware, they have a specific glass for each beer they serve. We're met by journalist Ian Guinard as we discuss the European feel behind this local bar.
This is something that I've seen a lot in Europe, but not as much in the States, and not really much in Canada either. There's so many different kinds of glasses, and then everyone has their own coaster.
Yeah, it reminds you of the beer culture in Europe.
Yeah.
Where, you know, the advertising on beer predates television. This used to be their way to get their brand image out there.
And it's not just about this glass and this coaster goes with this beer. There's also a style of service involved.
Some of it has to do with the service and the quality of the customer experience for drinking the beer. It's mostly advertising, but it makes it romantic.
Yeah.
It's the fun of it.
I want to challenge my international beer knowledge with Steve. So Ian gives a reduced version of the test they give to their bartenders. Ian will give us 6 different beers, and then we have to find the appropriate glassware and make sure the beer is served properly. Then he'll give us our score.
McKenna gets sent outside, and the test begins. Beer number 1 is the Boreal Russe. Lamprey finds the proper glass, easily locates the beer on tap. He sets it down and receives...
solid 7.
Beer number 2 is the Modit.
Getting thirsty.
While Lamprey searches for the glass, let's see what McKenna's up to. What a boob. Lamprey is on the pour.
Pour, oh, you're spilling a bit there.
Despite some spillage...
that was a solid 8.
Next up is the Kronbacher. The glassware for this is easy to spot. Lamprey fills the boot, and he's underpoured it. For that, he receives a 7. Next is a Belgian Trappist ale called Orval.
It's going to be
in a very specific glass.
Lamprey easily locates their very famous glass. He knows this beer is bottled, so he goes for the cooler, then pours it in the glass, and after a deduction for head size, receives a 9. Now onto St. Ambois Apricot Beer. Lamprey has no trouble with this one.
You're doing good. There. That's a 9 out of 10 again.
Last is the Paulwell Quack. Lamprey should have no problem finding this glass.
Ah.
Got it?
Yeah.
The trick with this beer is the pour. When the beer hits the neck...
whoa!
Ran off at the neck there.
It tends to foam.
I'm gonna put it in here.
He gets the last drops in.
That's a 10 out of 10, really. Beautiful.
Time.
That is a strong finish. Now it's McKenna's turn. McKenna also starts with the Boreal Russe, and he grabs the wrong glass. But he did the pour right. Because he has the wrong glass, he only scores a 5. Not off to a good start. Next is the Modit. McKenna's seeming to grab the first glass he sees.
There we go.
Wrong glass again, he gets a 6.
Oh.
Next up is the Kronbacher. He finds the right glass, but he's too short to grab it. He finally gets it, pours it.
Kronbacher.
Kronbacher.
Kronbacher. There's too many rules.
And sets it on the bar.
So, I feel good about that. That's a nice head.
For that, McKenna receives an 8. McKenna has no problem with the Orval.
I'll give you an 8 on that one.
All
that
right,
was fast,
cool.
Too.
The next beer is the Apricot from St. Ambois. McKenna grabs a beer and a glass, but neither are correct.
That's coming out pretty black for an apricot beer.
Oatmeal stout.
I gotta give you no more than a 4.
McKenna's last beer is the Quack.
Quack?
Yep.
He locates the bottle, then the glassware.
Yeah, careful there.
Paulwell Crack.
Nope. Paulwell Quack.
Just pour it out.
And that is why it has its own stand.
Wow, that
thing
doesn't
sit. Yeah, that's gonna hurt.
There's a lot of foam on the pour.
Oh, can I use nose grease?
No, you cannot use nose grease. Because of McKenna's nose grease, which actually worked in reducing the foam, he only gets 1 point.
That's an old college trick.
Should stay there.
That's not college beer.
We tally the final scores, and Lamprey gets a 50 out of 60, with McKenna getting a paltry 32. With a score like that, McKenna gets the boot.
Oh. Come on, we're passing around, guys.
No, we didn't get 32.
Hey, it's boot time. Very bootiful.
Coming up on Drinking Made Easy, things get a little hot.
I want you out for your glove.
They're fireproof.
Welcome back to Drinking Made Easy. If you want to know what's going on here, follow me on Twitter @ZaneLamprey.
It'll be wonderful.
Now we make our way to the champagne bar for this week's six-pack challenge.
Today's six-pack challenge is champagne sabering.
Allow me to demonstrate. First, remove the foil and put the bottle upside down in ice for about an hour. Next, remove the cage. Remember, at this point, the bottle is a loaded gun. Don't point it at anyone. Slide your saber and quickly slide it up the neck towards the rim. This will break the neck of the bottle, freeing the champagne from its glass prison. Do not try this at home. But remember, it is a free country.
Can we drink it?
Yeah, we can drink it.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Good luck.
The contestants have a pregame toast, and the competition begins.
He's stalling. I think he's nervous. I think it's my outfit.
Well, actually, Lamprey holds the world record for savoring the most bottles in 1 minute. This is only 6 bottles, so clearly this competition is already in the bag. He gets in position.
I'm ready.
Ready, set, go.
And he's solved. Oh, and he struggles on the first bottle. That is gonna cost him some valuable time. He cruises through bottle 3, 4, and 5. He pops number 6, stopping the clock with an official time of 9.7 seconds. It's a respectable time, but with that first bottle, he left the door wide open for McKenna.
Nice job.
Steve, you need to beat 9.7.
Lamprey knows that that first bottle may have cost him the match.
Kind of nervous.
McKenna has chosen to use a shorter house saber, thinking that it'll give him more speed.
Ready, set, go.
And he's off. McKenna comes out strong. He's flying through the bottles. He's already on his 4th. He sabers number 6 and stops the clock. 6.6 seconds. It looks like McKenna has beaten the current world record holder.
Yeah, I like that. I like this game. I'll drink to that. Good job, buddy.
Wow.
I think it's because I'm shorter. That was a trouncing, actually.
And McKenna is the winner of this week's six-pack challenge.
How about, it was rigged, it was stupid.
After suffering through that defeat, I need a drink. So we make our way over to the city's Old Port District. Known for their extensive craft cocktail list, L'Assommoir serves up some of Montreal's hottest craft cocktails. We team up with the head of mixology, Matthew Robillard, to find out how to make 2 truly Canadian cocktails.
So let's talk about the place.
It's been 8 years in the going. It's called L'Assommoir, like the novel of Émile Zola. If you look it up—
He's a big reader. He knows that book.
Émile Zola.
What's your favorite part of the book?
The end.
Yeah, definitely the ending.
Did you read in French? Or one of the many translations?
Yeah, he likes to mix it up.
Usually.
Yeah. So you guys make a lot of crafted cocktails.
Fresh fruits and herbs, it's our forte. Our cocktail list is very extensive. There's like 250.
The first drink we're making today is a maple milkshake, which is made with Canadian whiskey, ice cider, maple whiskey liqueur, ice cream, half and half, and maple syrup. We start by adding a scoop of ice to the blender, followed by Canadian whiskey, then ice cider, maple whiskey liqueur.
Stop.
Yeah, well, we'll just kill it.
We're in Canada, you know?
Now it's time to turn it into a milkshake. So I add ice cream.
Almost like desserts.
Then a little half and half. And of course, a squirt of maple goodness. Perfect. Blend it. And then pour into a tulip glass. Then garnish with a skewered cherry.
Voilà. And then a few straws.
Lamprey adds a straw, turning these innocent drinks into a race.
Really?
With a turn of his hat, it's clear that Lamprey is going over the top. These two competitors ready themselves.
Oh boy.
And Matthew starts them off.
Go.
And they're off. The boys suck hard, trying to get this frozen drink through their straws. Breaking the rules, Lamprey ditches the straws and goes straight for the glass. This strategy pays off as Lamprey jumps into the lead. McKenna follows suit.
It's cold.
And the brain freeze is kicking in.
I'm just like, I remember it.
But Lamprey powers through and takes the victory.
To cure our brain freeze, Matthew offers up his famous birthday shot.
We do a birthday shot, which is called L'Assommoir shot.
Hey, it's Steve's birthday today.
Happy birthday.
You have a special birthday shot that we could give Steve.
Exactly.
The L'Assommoir shot is made with vodka, raspberry liqueur, good old 151.
A fire-breathing shot?
Yeah, I don't think I'm gonna let you fire-breathe, though, because...
I don't think I'm gonna let you let me fire-breathe, so I'll let you do it.
It starts with 1.5 ounces of vodka, then 1/2 ounce of raspberry liqueur, Then Matthew pours a floater of 151. What makes this drink special is the way in which Matthew lights it. You probably shouldn't try this at home.
Watch out for your glove.
They're fireproof.
Or anywhere.
Nice.
Matthew finishes it off with a dash of cinnamon, then he cools the rim with ice so we don't burn ourselves.
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
That's what I call hot mixology. Coming up on Drinking Made Easy, evil science. Welcome back to Drinking Made Easy in Montreal.
For recipes you learned in today's show, go to drinkingmadeeasy.com.
Wah! Nous buvons au Montréal, and our next stop is Le Lab. Le Lab is a mixology bar with a bit of flair. Fabien Millard is a world-renowned flair bartender and a molecular mixologist. Along with making a bevy of original cocktails, Le Lab also does some experiments.
So you guys are doing literally the science of mixology in the lab.
Yes.
This is the lab.
We always bring and try to create a new flavor, a new taste.
This is your laboratory.
Yes.
And you do also some molecular mixology.
We use all kind of instruments to make a cocktail. We have a smoker, liquid nitrogen. We also have tools to make foam and stuff like that. Yes.
Okay. So molecular mixology is literally changing the molecular composition of the liquid.
Yeah.
So to turn it into a foam, or to turn it into ice cream or a sorbet.
Exactly.
That's molecular mixology.
Yeah.
Let's do some of that right now.
Okay.
Today, we'll be making a very cold drink called the Watermelon Fizz Sorbet, which is made with mint syrup, watermelon puree, lime juice, vodka, raspberry liqueur, and liquid nitrogen. Instead of the traditional shaker, this drink is made in a mixing bowl. I begin with a measure of mint-infused simple syrup, then a precise squeeze of fresh watermelon puree.
I don't ever overpour the ingredients, I overpour the alcohol. No one ever complains to me about that.
Freshly pressed lime juice, vodka, and raspberry liqueur. Then I head to the tank for some extremely cold liquid nitrogen.
You're good.
I pour in the liquid nitrogen and whisk it with the ingredients. This freezes it, changing its molecular structure from a liquid to a solid.
That's a fun drink.
After a minute of evil mixing, we then scoop out our frozen cocktail, which hasn't lost any of the alcohol. Like a proper cocktail, it gets a garnish.
It's like science meets art.
In what regards?
Well, the science and the art, they meet.
That's nice of you to say, but if you're really going to make an analogy, it's like chemistry meets mixology. There, that's it. I did it.
There you go.
Cheers, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Steve, I don't envy your hobbit hands.
And unlike a traditional cocktail, you don't drink it, you eat it.
No, it's smooth.
Yeah, it's perfect for summertime.
And this is really the only way you're going to be able to make a frozen drink with this much alcohol in it.
Yeah.
Because otherwise it just wouldn't freeze.
Yeah, it's the only way we can.
How cold is the liquid nitrogen?
Under 80.
180 below?
Yeah.
I think that's how cold it is on the moon.
Would you say we?
Our last stop is a Belgian-inspired brew pub. When they first opened, Benelux began brewing Belgian-style ales. But as the brewery grew, so did their taste for hops. So now they also brew beers similar to the hoppy West Coast IPA. Karine Charon has agreed to take us on a journey through the many different styles of beer offered by this Montreal hotspot. Belgian beers obviously have been around for a long time, but the hoppy style is kind of something new, especially for the area,
right? It's kind of recent, but I would say it's like fashion. A couple of years ago, it was IPAs, put as much hops as you can.
Right.
I like the hop.
You will be happy. So you try the sabotage.
I'll try some hops.
Hold on. All right, so you have this sheet, and this is a journey that people can go on.
It is.
To learn about beer. So this is a flight. Why do you have them going in this particular order?
The thing is, if you start with a very bitter beer, it's gonna kill your taste.
Right.
So if you have a softer beer, then after, you're not gonna taste it as much. So unless you take something even
more hoppy, more alcohol. So you start people on the wit beer. May we have three of those, please, as we begin our journey into the world of beer.
The first stop on our journey is the Gaia, a German-style wheat beer. Corrine pours us three tasters.
Where's the rest of it? Because it's small.
Cheers. I think you probably, you know.
Tell them.
So it has sort of a clovey taste to it.
Orange.
Orange, for sure.
Yeah, orange peel, like.
A little bit orange zest, we'll agree with that. Can we agree on cloves?
I got a little clove.
I think we
cloves.
Can.
So that was 4% alcohol. Uh-huh. Let's continue our journey.
Next is the Candide, a 6.5% Belgian amber.
Two Belgian ambers.
Cheers.
We waste no time drinking that one.
This definitely has more going on.
Mm-hmm.
A little bit more mouthfeel to it, and more
sweeter,
alcohol.
For sure.
Yeah, a little more malty.
A little more malty. Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly.
Beer number three is Zealand.
They added a special hop from New Zealand that is perfumed with grapefruit.
And it is 7.7%. You gotta slow down. We have a long night ahead of us. My goodness.
Cheers.
What's left?
As you can see, this one is very easy to drink.
It really does have a grapefruit finish.
Well, wait until you taste the next one.
I don't want to wait. I want it right now.
Right now.
Sabotage
Good.
Me.
Finally, we make it to the sabotage.
Cheers.
Cheers, guys. Woo! That's very hoppy.
It's dry hop, so you really have that bitterness
yeah.
on your tongue.
Even through this mustache, I taste the vegetalia.
As we come to the end of our flight and the end of the show, we have our last beer called Amok.
Cheers.
Cheers.
To Amok.
Cheers, guys.
While I choose to savor our last beer, Steve takes a different approach.
Lovely.
Wow.
I love the way your mustache blows into the foam.
The walrus tusks.
And on that classy note, I think it's time to call it a night. Check us out on Facebook and at drinkingmadeeasy.com.